called to be saints. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. So don't you see that we don't owe this old do-it-yourself life one red cent? There's nothing in it for us, nothing at all. The best thing to do is to give it a decent burial and get on with your new life. God's Spirit beckons. There are things to do and places to go. This resurrection life we receive from God is not a timid, brave, tending life. It's adventurously expectant, greeting God with a childlike, "What's next, Papa?" God's Spirit touches our spirits and confirms who we really are. We know who God is, and we know who we are, parents and children. And we know we are going to get what's coming to us, an unbelievable inheritance. We go through exactly what Christ goes through. If we go through the hard times with him, then we're certainly going to go through the good times with him. That's why I don't think there's any comparison between the present hard times and the coming good times. The created world itself could hardly wait for what's coming next. Everything in creation is being more or less held back. God reigns it in until both creation and the creatures, and all the creatures are ready and can be released at the same moment into the glorious times ahead. Meanwhile, the joyful anticipation deepens. All around us, we observe a pregnant creation. The difficult times of pain throughout the world are simply birth pangs. But it's not only around us, it's within us. The Spirit of God is arousing us within. We're also feeling the birth pangs. These sterile and barren bodies of ours are yearning for full deliverance. That is why waiting does not diminish us, any more than waiting diminishes a pregnant mother. We are enlarged in the waiting. We, of course, don't see what is enlarging us, but the longer we wait, the larger we become, the more joyful our expectancy. To the only wise God, through Jesus Christ, be the glory forever. Amen. This is the word of God. The word of God to the church in Rome 2,000 years ago, and the word to us today.
May God's word come alive in us.
So last week, for those of you who weren't here, we had a Bible study in the morning. I know most of us came in the afternoon, right, to celebrate Davin's ordination, which was a really wonderful time. But the conversation that happened in the morning has really stuck with me. We were reading from last week's part of Romans, as we've been doing all summer, in these letters from Paul. And at the end of our conversation, one member of our group noted that the kind of life described by Paul, being full of the resurrected life of Jesus, and so free from the concerns that trap us into cycles of worry, that sounded so good. That it was just what she needed. But she couldn't feel it. I think that all of us have been in that position at one time or another, right? We wanted so badly to believe, to feel, and we were left with the same empty frustrations that we always had. Judy then told the story of when she first came to know Jesus and how her life changed in an instant, her nightly tears relieved and hope installed in their place. My goodness, how we need Judy to keep telling us her story, her testimony, because it gives us hope. Not all of us have had that same experience. And then another member of the group said, you know, we don't always have to feel something in order for it to have an impact on our lives. Think of medications, he said. You may not feel any difference at first, but that doesn't mean that they aren't working, aren't shifting something deep within your cells. Sometimes hope is hanging on to what we desperately want to be true, what we defiantly believe, even when it doesn't feel real. There were no odd looks, I don't think, when we pulled out our first hymn, but lots of really good singing. That's a classic Easter hymn, so it might seem like a strange choice for the middle of the summer. But I always liked it because it's one of my dad's favorites. But it's not only in his honor that we pulled it out today. There's some really good theology in that hymn to help us understand Paul's point of view in the letter to the Romans. You can take it out again if you want to look at what the words say. The resurrected Christ arises a victor with a mighty triumph, living to reign. My favorite is the second verse. Vainly they watch his death. Vainly they seal the dead. Jesus embodies this defiant, unstoppable force of life. And then in the last verse, he tore the bars away. Jesus has defeated death forever. For Paul, our lives are defined less by the personal, individual choices that we make and more by the initiative of God, whose resurrection life and love are strong enough to defeat the powers of sin and death. That's what he's talking about when he recommends that we give this old do-it-yourself life a decent burial. That we get over the idea that we can somehow be good enough, or that we have the power to save ourselves. That we give all of that up to trust in the one who actually can save us, who has defeated death forever. And that's the resurrection life that Paul goes on to describe. Our friend Eugene, the author of the Message paraphrase that we've been reading from, he adds this beautiful metaphor of pregnancy to really help us get into the idea. Because Paul knew, and Eugene's pastoral sense told him, just how difficult it would be for us to believe and live in the conviction that God had defeated sin and death forever. Aside from the times that we simply don't feel it, there is so much in this world that feels like evidence that the powers of sin and death are winning. Far from arising a victor from the dark domain, we wonder where Jesus is and if God's love is real. Hatred, greed, racism, illness, anxiety, depression, poverty, inequality, debt, these are all the signs and symptoms of death in our world and in our lives. How can we be expected to believe that God has triumphed when these foes loom so large? I don't really know the answer to that question, except to repeat to myself, to repeat to you, just like taking a pill every morning, that death will not have the last word. That God's love is stronger than all the mess we see around us, whether we feel it or not. Paul knew that it was difficult to believe things not seen, and so he tells us that is the very definition of hope. And Eugene's lovely metaphor can help us, I think. Imagine a pregnant woman, if you have been pregnant or know someone who has been. Her job for 9 months is mostly waiting, right? At the end, there will be a baby, but until then, waiting. She doesn't consciously work to construct the baby herself, but she's anything but still, right? Instinctively, behind the scenes of her conscious mind, her body knows what to do. And because she knows, because she believes that that baby is growing within her own flesh, a woman might change many things about the way she lives. Prenatal vitamins, or dietary changes, or nesting, or sleeping more, or sleeping less. Acting as if this thing that is not yet visible is real and will one day meet her face to face. That's the kind of active waiting that Paul is describing. God is at work within each one of us and within us as a community, calling us to the expected hope of Jesus' resurrection life, calling us to believe that although we might not see it face to face for a while, God is working to set all things right. What if, like the medications we take each morning, what if we took this knowledge into ourselves as well? With the same kind of faith that even if we don't immediately feel a difference, it is working. I almost want to say, fake it till you make it. It's kind of it. Like that man in the gospel story who says to Jesus when he asks him to heal his son, I believe, help in my unbelief. Even as we live surrounded by the signs of death and sin, we can assert defiantly, preposterously, that God's love and life are more powerful still. Like the expected mother who changes her behavior, who prepares her home and surroundings, I wonder what kind of changes this conviction might bring about in us. Even if we still don't feel the immediate relief, even if everything is not sorted out once and for all, if we hold on to the belief that Jesus' resurrection life is at work within us, what difference might it make? I think kind of the fact that we even feel unease, that we, as Eugene puts it, that we are yearning for full deliverance, I think the fact that we feel that in and of itself is a sign that God's Spirit is at work within us. And if we can't yet get to hope, if we aren't quite ready to believe, if we still don't feel it, we can at least hold on to that, our own discomfort, as proof that a different kind of life is possible. These words feel to me at the same time powerful and revolutionary and also paltry and meaningless. When we can feel the effects of sin and death so clearly and powerfully around us, what hope do our beliefs and convictions have? But I think even around us, even in the world and in our own lives, sin and death are not the only powers, right? There are signs of life and love, too, aren't there? This congregation's commitment over Lent to learn about difference and power and try to dismantle racism and hatred among us, if I'm honest with you, because of that experience, I believe now more than I did before that God is building God's kingdom here among us. The way that this congregation has rallied around any of our members who are sick or suffering, the way we were there for Barbara this week in the wake of her husband's death, that helps me feel the resurrection power of God at work among us. The simplest things of our life together, the care with which dishes were washed after our celebration last week, or tables wiped down, the commitment of this group of people to pool their money to create a space where God's kingdom can thrive, the emphatic embrace of our children as a part of our body, these are the signs that life and love are at work, that Jesus' resurrection life is growing within and among us. This is why the waiting does not diminish us, Paul tells us. Any more than waiting diminishes a pregnant mother, we are enlarged in the waiting. We, of course, don't see what is enlarging us, but the longer we wait, the larger we become, and the more joyful our expectancy. Across 2,000 years, Paul's prayer for us continues to come through loud and clear, that we may not be diminished in our waiting, that we may be enlarged, and the larger we come, the more joyful our expectancy.